was the most famous tiger in the world. I named her Matchley. I've spent 13 years following her incredible life. The greatest fighter I've ever seen. And the greatest mother. She came to rule over Ranthambore National Park, became its queen, and founded a dynasty. Now she's old and frail. She doesn't have much time left. I've come to find my old friend for one last time, to say goodbye. Even in my personal life, I've always tried to go and see people before they've died and not go to their funerals. That's just the way I prefer it. It seems to me it makes a lot more sense. What a character. What a character. She has given me a lifetime of memories. This is her story. I've come back to Ranthambore National Park in India to find Matchley for the last time. Little did I know when we first met that she would change my life forever.
How's it going, buddy?
My constant companion during that time was a local guide called Salim.
Good to see you, buddy.
In fact, I met him just about the same time I met Matchley.
Excellent. I can't wait to chat.
He always keeps an eye on her during my absence.
Ah, good to be back.
We've done this so many times together. This place feels like our second home. I guess my life changed completely when I got a phone call one afternoon offering me the chance to go to this place, Ranthambore, in India. I'd never heard of the place. A few weeks later, I arrived. I was a relatively inexperienced wildlife cameraman. I knew very little about tigers. Salim back then didn't really have much of an idea either. We had to find a tiger that was at an interesting stage in its life.
How fresh do you reckon these hoof marks are?
Dead from the morning.
But there was one tigress that we found. She was only 18 months old. She had just left her mother. She was striking out on her own. Her mother had already kicked her two sisters out of this territory. But it didn't look like Matchley was going anywhere. My Hindi wasn't great.
If I'd known she was going to become the world's most famous tiger, I probably wouldn't have called her Fish, because it's not the best name for a tiger I've ever heard.
There was something about her. She was just feisty. So we decided to follow her. In many ways, she became my jungle guru, my jungle teacher. And through her, I met her mother. Now, she at the time ruled this lake area. This youngster, her daughter, was walking around the place like she owned it. I knew there was going to be a showdown to win this prime lakeside territory. As I followed her, it became obvious that these two were on a collision course. Her mother seemed both surprised and disgusted to see her there. And Matchley wasn't giving way. Matchley got a nasty nick on her chest. Her future depended on winning these battles with her mother. And over the next few weeks, I witnessed several of these encounters. The final clash was set to take place amidst the palace ruins. Matchley's mother was still laying claim to these ruins. Matchley knew this was serious. But Matchley wasn't giving up any ground. Seeing Matchley dethrone her mother made me realize that she was going to be something special. Her mother disappeared soon after that. Matchley, through her skills as a fighter, had become the queen of one of the world's prime tiger territories. You have a combination of fort, cliffs, lakes, wildlife every place. It's beyond our imaginations. Seeing Matchley move through this landscape was just a dream for a cameraman. All the animals constantly reacting to her. There's nothing, no place like it in the world. No place like it in the world. Now, 13 years on, I can't wait to catch up with my old friend Matchley. We've traveled this road so many times that it always looks different. Right now, there's been a good monsoon this year, so the vegetation growth has been really, really strong. And although that's really good for the animals, it's good for the deer and for all the things that tigers want to eat, it's actually going to make actually spotting tigers kind of difficult. There's so many places to hide. But at least with Matchley, we know her so well that we've got a pretty good chance of tracking her down. But
Well, she's an old lady now. Her habits are changing. So actually tracking her down and, you know, having a good look at her is not going to be that easy. She's having this information. There are a lot of animals in this area, and if she was to start moving, we'd soon hear about it. They'd all start alarm calling. It's so quiet around here these days. I'm pretty certain Matchley doesn't come here anymore. Very quiet. So Matchley was at a very interesting stage in her life now. Inheriting the territory that you grow up in is a massive advantage. It means that Matchley already knew every nook and cranny of this place. But she was relatively inexperienced, and she still had to learn to deal with the other creatures found in her territory. Sloth bears, one of the most aggressive creatures you're ever likely to come across. She knew when to retreat and picked her battles well. She was gaining experience all the time. And in a way, we were both learning our trades together. Her home range was absolutely full of prey. But that can be a disadvantage too. It only takes one animal to spot her. And the element of surprise is gone.
She's coming for me.
But she's not giving up. Her favorite food. She's still got a lot to learn. What is the next thing that's going to be in a tigress's mind? That's meeting a male and having a family. As luck would have it, there was this beautiful, perfectly handsome, big male tiger called Bomburam who came calling one Christmas day. And she got very excited at this, and she was going around. She spent days roaring. She had picked up his scent. She knew he was in the area. And then I shall never forget the day. I was listening to this roaring, and she stopped. And in the distance, I heard an answering call. That was to be my Christmas present. Unbelievable. Mr. was the first time I had seen a male and female together, and I could see the difference in size. He totally dominated her in size. Beautiful big male. So excited, and they started making right beside our vehicle, and they did it repeatedly for days and days. It's a great sight to see. By choosing the dominant male, she'd selected the best genes around. Bombu Ram was well known to be incredibly powerful, so hopefully any offspring they had together would inherit those same characteristics. There's a very good chance that the next generation was on its way. Another day and still no sign of Matchley. I'm really pretty certain she doesn't come here anymore now. She's changed her habits so much. She's not moving around anywhere near as much as she used to. She used to use these forest trails all the time because they were the easiest way of moving through the park. And if she's lying down quietly under the tree, there's no evidence as to where she is. See Matchley anywhere? Any of you guys seen Matchley? No? The park guards confirm my suspicions. Matchley has been evicted from her territory, almost certainly by one of her daughters, from her fourth and final litter. This means she will be more reclusive and harder to find. Matchley was one day seen coming from the bush and making this little call. And I had never heard it before, because I'd never seen a tiger family before when there were small cubs. It's a very gentle little call that the tigress makes for her cubs to say, come on, follow. So Matchley stepped out on the road, and then came these tiny little cubs with her. My future was sort of mapped out for me. The fact that she had these cubs, my job was then to follow those cubs for as long as I possibly could and watch them grow up. So Matchley had produced two cubs. She'd gotten them through the first monsoon and they were now about a year old. As a first-time mum, that's pretty impressive, because I'm sure lots of first-time mums lose their first cubs. So Matchley was already proving herself as something special.
taught me so much about this place. And in many ways we were at a similar stage in our lives. And she became a mother, I became a father. So we have that in common. I've got two wonderful little male cubs, two beautiful female cubs. And through my work here, by following that species, put food on the table, giving me shelter, all that sort of thing. So I'm grateful to her for that. I look back upon this time as being my halcyon days in Grand Laborde. Being able to have that opportunity to watch a tiger family growing up around the lakes and to have had that lucky break really of choosing the right tigers. I mean, I don't know how many times I thought to myself, I could easily have chosen another one. We've moved off and set up a territory someplace else. I just happened to choose naturally. Cubs are with their mums for about at least 18 or 20 months. It's a long period of time. And you have to feed them during that time, and as they get bigger you have to supply a lot of food. So she became an expert hunter. She seemed to hunt extremely efficiently. From a cameraman's point of view, she normally hunted extremely efficiently behind a bush. That's the nature of tigers. And everyone would say to you, did you get a kill? Did you get a kill? Ah, well, I got the beginning of it. Or I got the end of it. But don't ask me if I got a kill. It's not the most interesting thing tigers do anyway. It's always fascinated me how a tigress tells her cubs, how she tells them, I don't know, but she tells them to stay there, I'm going off hunting. She wouldn't have a chance if she brought them with her. It's very important too that she leaves them in a safe place, and it's important that the cubs learn to stay there. But Matchley was incredibly good at this. It was just another example really of what a great mother she was. Close to the water, in the reeds, they were well hidden, so no other predator could find them, because they were really too young to defend themselves. The cubs were able to enjoy a wonderful time, because Matchley had provided them with safety and security. In her absence, they used to get up to all sorts of mischief. Sharing this domain with crocodiles, another apex predator, meant that they often came into close contact. Other than large male tigers, crocodiles were the one true adversary for Matchley. Thank you. terrorized the lake waters from above and below. And always took advantage of stragglers. It was around this time that Matsu took them on at their own game. This incredible footage shows her killing a fully grown crocodile. It confirmed to me that she was no ordinary tigress. She was the true queen of the lakes. Everything had been going really well for Matsuki until then. She'd learned how to deal with her mother, she'd learned how to deal with her sisters, she'd set up an exclusive territory right around the lakes, probably the best territory in terms of prey in the whole of Rampenborg. And the biggest, most powerful male around had fathered her cubs. But soon afterwards, Bongo disappeared. And none of us were quite sure why. There was a worrying threat that it may have been poaching. But one thing we knew for sure, Matsuki's life was going to change from this point on. A new male was going to move in, and he could be a serious threat to Matsuki's cubs. My worst fears were realized when I started finding huge male pug rocks getting closer and closer to Matsuki's territory. I came to the spot one morning like any other morning I used to pass through here every day, and I suddenly saw the new male at last had come to the very heart of Matsuki's territory. He was investigating what was going on here. Were blissfully unaware of the danger they were in. Over the next few weeks, I started to see this male more and more. We called him Nick. And the new challenge for Matsuki was, how was she going to deal with this new male? He was young and inexperienced, but he was still huge compared to her, and a real danger. If he tracked her down, he tracked her down relentlessly. He just knew where she was. And he was clearly in the mood for mating. And even more worryingly, he knew where those cubs were. So Matsuki had an incredibly difficult challenge on her hands. She was up and down on the ground, making sure she wasn't available to him, positioning herself very carefully. He was sniffing in the scent. He was trying to work out exactly what was going on with her. And as he walked towards me, he seemed very on edge.
this had been going on for some weeks, I came back to this very place and I saw Matchley looking very anxious indeed. The male was circling her. And then they came to this almost like an arena. It was made for a fight and she just lunged straight at him. And she beat him. It didn't last very long, but tiger fights cannot last long because they would seriously injure each other. But what was amazing, at the end of the fight, both Matchley and the male bowed to each other. Now, I'd seen this very same thing happen at the end of mating when there's often aggression. And this sort of bow seems to mean, we've had enough, let's not continue with this. That's it, the aggression seems to just disappear and they part. What she had done, she played a magnificent game of combining seductress on the one hand, keeping him interested enough not to hurt her. But he walked away as the injured party. He was definitely out of action for a couple of days. With a pad cut like that, you can't hunt. She had won this encounter, and for the sake of her cubs, it was such an important encounter to win. This distinguishes second-rate tigers from first-rate tigers, if you like. She was the queen of Ranthambore now. She could control this dominant male. These days, I've discovered that Matchley rarely uses these roads like she used to. Fresh tracks. Nice ones. We've been finding sporadic female pug marks crossing the road in a tiny corner of her former territory.
Yeah, these are fresh. Go on, jolly.
At last we found some physical indication that we're actually on her trail and that she's still alive.
I knew this wasn't going to be easy. Her needs, her requirements are so different than it used to be. She's now a tigress just surviving on her own. So she's keeping a really low profile and that's completely opposite of the Matchley I knew.
Angela.
And although she's in a relatively small area, maybe a couple of square kilometres, if she doesn't move, she's pretty much impossible to find. So I'm starting to get a little concerned as to whether I'm going to see her at all.
Every track and trail in Matchley's territory seems to hold some sort of memory for me. Some of them now look just sort of empty and desolate and you think nothing had ever happened there. This was the spot. But on this particular road, it looks like a very ordinary piece of road now. A most extraordinary event happened one day, one I shall never forget. And probably for me, the single greatest thing I ever filmed as a cameraman. I shall never forget the day. I come in the park that morning and she had gone hunting and left the two cubs behind in cover. And a few hours later, way in the distance, I heard a roaring. And then it got louder and louder as she came through the lakes. No. came walking towards me, towards me, towards me, roaring all the way. So I knew she was calling the cubs. She came right past my vehicle and then lay down on the road. And I simply couldn't believe what happened next. I heard rustling in the bushes, and first of all, out stepped the first cub, and he lay down on the road, quickly followed by the second one. But they weren't just lying beside her and nuzzling her, they were actually suckling her. They were using their paws to sort of stimulate milk production, like they would have done when they were youngsters. I don't think anyone had ever recorded a tigress sucking almost 2-year-old cubs before. Matchley knew what she was doing, that's for sure. It's as if she was saying goodbye to her two boys. Because that was the last time I ever saw them together as a family unit. When the two cubs suddenly disappeared, I started to get worried. There have been rumors when Balderam disappeared too that poaching was starting again in Ranbanvoor. It's periodically been a huge problem in this part of the world. It turned out that poaching was to blame for the disappearance of at least one of Matchley's first set of cubs. Around this time, poaching accounted for up to 25 tiger deaths in Ranbanvoor. And in the neighbouring tiger reserve of Sariska, every single tiger was killed by poaching. Ranbanvoor is a major religious site and pilgrims flock here in huge numbers. In fact, over Matchley's lifetime, perhaps 10 million people have come into the heart of her territory. She knew how to disappear when she needed to disappear, and perhaps she was able to detect benign people from dangerous people. Although I'd like to believe she had some sort of sixth sense and knew how to avoid poachers, the truth is she probably survived because she lived in the most heavily protected part of Ranbanvoor. Cattle grazers would sometimes come into her territory during the monsoon, but she avoided eating cattle and hence avoided coming into conflict. Clever girl. Perhaps she learned from her mother, who had survived a similar poaching crisis during the early 90s. Our search for Matchley is taking us deeper and deeper into the park.
Fresh pug marks. Tell it.
The female pug marks had become more consistent around a little gorge called La Carda. I'm pretty sure now this is where she's got to be.
Very quiet. Peaceful place, isn't it? Must be sitting quietly here somewhere. It's one of the most beautiful little bits of the planet. She has always loved this place. She was born here. I'm quite sure that this is where she's going to die. Worst places to die. It's one of the most beautiful little bits of the planet as far as I'm concerned. She's brought me to so many beautiful places on our journey together. Our little boy won't be the same without her. By the time Matchley's first cubs had left her, she was about 4.5 years old. Irony of ironies, that male that she fought, and that male that she could have been killed by, he had now become the dominant male of this area. There was this amazing sort of reversal in his fortunes, I suppose. She now had to go and befriend him. And he was to become the father of her second litter. In the second litter, there was one male and one female. But this time that family was able to be raised in the security of having the dominant male around. So that changed everything for her. It became a much more straightforward sort of raising of the family. She raised 4 litters, with 2 in the first, 2 in the second, 2 in the third, and 3 in the fourth. She's been a wonderful mother, and by far the most successful tigress in Ranthambore. I think one of the keys to Matchley's success was her ability to manipulate males. I witnessed an incredible example of this when she was rearing her 3rd family of 2 cubs. Came round a corner, and there in front of me was the most amazing sight. Matchley fast asleep on the road, the most relaxed I'd ever seen her, as were the cubs. And then the cubs, as cubs will do, started to get a little bit bored, so one of them got up and started wandering down the roads. So I thought, I'll follow. And then I noticed the cub was looking slightly alert, slightly anxious. And I looked into the bushes at the back, and there was another tiger. It was a great big male head. If there was no relationship between these animals, the tiger could get up and kill that cub easily. So it was a moment of great tension. This was the first time I had ever seen the tiger we called X-Male, because we knew he existed, but we never saw him. I was absolutely holding my breath. As soon as he looked up, the cub's posture changed immediately, and he quickly moved in, right up beside the tiger that was obviously his dad, because they started playing with each other. So this was the first time I'd ever really seen a tiger family together. And from a cameraman's point of view, it was mostly hidden, slightly behind the bushes, but for me, it meant absolutely everything. This was a moment I'd always wanted to witness, was happening right in front of me. Thank you. Now, male tigers are big territories and they will have several females within their territory, possibly several families. And it seems to me that they patrol and visit each of those families on a regular basis. Now, Matchley, it seemed, was allowing this male in to share kills with her. From her point of view, if she gives almost a reward for him being in the area, he's more likely to come to that area on a regular basis, and hence her cubs will be protected from the intrusions of other males. I'm sure it's something that happens with tigresses generally, but it seems that Matchley was very, very good at establishing relationships with males throughout her life. She's a smart girl, and that relationship she's had with males over the years has really fascinated me, because it's something we really didn't know an awful lot about in tigers. Her last litter, 3 female cubs, always successful. This was the perfect situation. Rantha bore 3 female cubs on the lakes. It was almost like a mirror of what Matchley had been for. That's how she'd been brought up. She had held sway in the lakes for almost a decade, and her life as a fighter was beginning to take its toll on the aging tigress. One thing that a tiger needs to successfully kill is good strong canines. They are known as the killing teeth, and Matchley was starting to lose her canines. Each time I saw her, I could see her physical prowess was ebbing away. This queen was about to lose her crown to one of those closest to her. My feeling was that one of these daughters had just inherited a bit more of Matchley than the other ones. Ironically, Matchley's success at controlling and reproducing with alpha males had resulted in this incredibly powerful daughter, a worthy rival with all her cunning and aggression. She was ready to kick Matchley out and take over the lake territory. First, she had to defeat her sisters, starting with the youngest and weakest. Relatively straightforward, but her elder sister, bigger and stronger than her. With her 2 sisters out of the way, she then turned her attention to her mother. And Matchley was waiting, almost as if she knew what was going to happen. The tables were turned. Matchley's reign was about to come to an end. That short interaction was all it took. A queen deposed by her own daughter. Matchley was intelligent enough to know when to back down. This is how she had survived to become something very rare, an elderly tigress. It was soon after this that she left the lakes for good and began her life as a recluse, avoiding all other members of her kind. And that's why she's been so hard to find. People often refer to tigers as being solitary animals, but in fact, Machli has spent much of her life in the company of other tigers, Lolu's family she's raised. But now she's a very different animal. Now she's got to avoid all contact with members of her kind. And that sort of makes me sad to think that she's out there now all by herself, all alone. It's a sad old way for such a dominant tigress to sort of, for things to end, but I hope I get to see her the next few days, because I have a feeling if I don't, I'll never see her again. I wonder where she is right now. Once she was kicked out of the lakes, Machli had to find a new way of surviving in her old age. Making kills was now really difficult for her. She'd lost all her canines. But one thing's for sure, when she was lucky enough to make a kill, she wanted to protect it. Protecting your hard-earned meal from other tigers can be fraught with danger. And there's nothing more dangerous than a marauding male. She needs to stay out of his way. I've never seen a tiger look more nervous. It was really hard for me to watch. But she still wasn't going away. The sight of him stealing her kill is just too much for her. And she lets him know she's not happy. That is not a good idea. She just doesn't give up. Fight her till the bitter end. After all these years, that feistiness that first attracted me to her has not diminished in the slightest. That's what makes Machli so special to me. My final day here. Strange feeling. I've been thinking about this day for some time. career match and he's in here. If I was to guess, I'd say that she's been on a carcass because I can hear the sounds of crows and tree pies in there. And she should move. She should move because it's getting warmer and warmer. And if I know Matchley, by the time it gets to maybe 10 o'clock this morning, it'll be about 110 degrees, and she'll move to water, because she loves sitting in the water. But whatever happens, I'm not going to move from this place all day. I think there's something even going on with peacock alarm calls. I think she's on the move. She's coming. She's coming. She's coming. I came to see her now, and I'm leaving her looking good. I have no desire to see her when she's dead. I don't need that. I prefer just to see her looking healthy, well-fed, well-watered. Because this whole I guess, you know, we've been on a long journey together, Matchley and I, 13 years. I'm so glad I came to see her for the last time. It's like even in my personal life, I've always tried to go and see people before they've died and not go to their funerals. That's just the way I prefer it. It seems to me it makes a lot more sense. And to have been able to come back here and to see Matchley still looking in good health, still at least in the tiny parts of her former therapy, still alive, looking good, and leaving her today lying in the shade of a jamun tree, that's the image I'm going to take away from this place. I'll never have a relationship with another wild tiger like that again. You know, people say there are more tigers in the forest, you know, there's plenty of fish in the sea, but not for me. That's a once in a lifetime.
Stay with us here on BBC HD. Jack Whitehall and Jimmy Carr are among the guests on tonight's QI. Up next.